So thanks very much for to Clara and to the organizer to allow me this opportunity to be here, as you may know, and I have been working in Lyon some time ago, for a long time, in fact, and in fact I moved to Nice 5 years ago, a little bit more, I should say. And in fact, most of the work I was talking about today, in fact, was initiated in Lyon when I was working at the École Normale Supérieure at Gerland. And so the title is Genome-wide Outcome of Telomere Signaling is rather vague. And it's just to say that it is, in fact, a path that I follow for a long time to understand the influence of the extremity of our chromosomes for the whole genome functioning. So in fact, when I start to work on repetitive DNA, I say Peter, and more particularly at telomere, I was starting my team in Lyon in 93, so some time ago again. In fact, those working on telomere, facing to the questions of the linearity of our chromosomes, which is a real challenge not only for biologists, but also for the cell and for the molecular mechanism inside the cells. And the fact that we, I would say all eukaryotes, some bacteria, have a linear chromosome, in fact, pose at least two types of problems, molecular problems, that have a translation in a cellular and organismal mechanism. So the first, so these two problems are very classical and they are taught at the university. The first one, I will not go into too much molecular details, but the first problem is the so-called end replication problem. I mean, briefly, the conventional replication machinery, as you know, is capable to replicate all our chromosomes. It's a metastable situation, so I will try to secure the things. Okay, and except at the very end, and because of the asymmetric progression of the fork, so I don't go into detail, but the final product at the end of the S phase of our chromosome is in fact a loss of some nucleotide. And this is inexorable, it has to be like that. Obviously, it must exist some solution for that. And one solution that was invented during evolutions is a particular enzyme that is now well known and got the Nobel Prize, not the enzyme, but the discoverer, Liz Blackburn, who discovered this enzyme in 1985. And And this enzyme is a reverse transcriptase that is able to compensate, I mean, the erosions and the degradation occurs, but this enzyme just compensates it. And but the problem is that, in fact, this enzyme exists mostly during our embryonic life and in germ cells. That means that we are able to transmit to our progeny the same amount of telomeres that we receive from our parents, but disappear as soon as we were born. And during our adult life and early development. In fact, this enzyme does not exist anymore in our somatic cells, and in fact, we are programmed because of that to lose our telomeric DNA. I'm sorry, it's like that. It's the bad news of the day. And the second problem, which is in fact, molecularly speaking, totally different somehow, with some connections with telomerase, is the fact that the extremity of DNA is highly unstable in cell. And the reason is very simple, it's because it is recognized as an accidental DNA damage. And as such, it is taken into account by the classical DNA damage response pathway, DDR pathway, that give rise to two types of events. One, which is a rapid cell cycle arrest, to avoid, of course, deleterious replications, and also to repair. When possible, and the repair of a double strand break is mostly by recombinations, and specifically for chromosome ends, non-homologous end joining. So, of course, and this is really the, One of the concepts that emerged from the early, very pioneer work of Barbara McClintock and Müller, who got also the Nobel Prize, not only for telomere, but in part for that, is to say that at natural chromosomes, because we are linear, it must exist a mechanism to protect, in fact, against this instability that Weber detected at that time, after, in fact, mostly irradiations of cells in the middle of 20th century. Anyway, so this the solution for that is not telomerase. The solution is a particular chromatin structure. And this chromatin structure is really unusual because it's not based on the classical nucleosome, but it's based on a particular protein complex named shelterin that, in fact, provides some specificity of binding to telomeric DNA through two subunits, TRF1 and TRF2, that specifically recognize the simple repeats that constitute the end of our chromosomes, TTAGGG, repeated several hundred of times. And really forming the very last protein of our chromosomes with a very terminal protein named POT1 that in fact binds to the 3' overhang that that constitutes the end of our chromosomal DNA. And very interestingly, in fact, it's really a coupling complex because you have a protein bridge between the very terminal POT1 and the duplex part of this complex through protein-protein interactions, TPP1 and TIN2, that really make a cap. You don't have to see it like some kind of magic cap, in fact, because it is really a multifunctional complex. And we will see that it has several functions, and even outside telomere, and it will be a large part of my work. So to summarize that in a more dynamic view during our ontogeny, let's say, so we, as I said, we decrease the length of our telomeric DNA, and at the beginning, in early adult life, it has not so much consequence, and because the erosion is very little. But up to a certain point, and particularly probably in stem cells, in adult stem cells, in fact, the telomere becomes very short, so short that they are recognized as such by the cells, not totally like a double strand break. And you see here, so this is the protection mechanism against the DDR, the recombinations and the checkpoint. But you see that when this is naturally occurring in our body, when the telomere becomes short, but not totally lost. This is a very important point. In fact, you are still protecting against recombination. That means that you are still protecting against chromosomal instability. But you partially, I would say, activate the DDR by activating the two kinases, ATM and TR, that give rise to the classical DDR checkpoint signaling that give rise mostly to senescence, in some cases to apoptosis. And regarding sheltering, during this the Western pattern of Jung cells, so this is the Western pattern of all cells, it's not only that the telomere becomes shorter, in fact, some sheltering proteins that are this capping complex, in fact, decrease, particularly the case of TRF2, not all of them, a little bit TRF1, and largely TPP1. That means that mostly, not only that you decrease the length, but also you decrease the capacity of this complex to cap our chromosomal ends. And this is, of course, a key question now in the field to understand how it works in details. And it is more and more believed, and mostly based on rare genetic diseases where these components are genetically modified, but also, as usual, for many mouse models, that in fact, this accumulation of senescent cells with age in fact, contribute to age-related pathology. So, as I said, for rare genetic disease, but maybe, and this is a key challenge in the field now, maybe general age-related pathology of the general populations, including cancer, obviously, which the major risk factor, of course, is age for cancer, not all of them, but most of them, but particularly carcinoma. And now it's really a question to understand the link between this pathway and the appearance of this age-related pathology in general. So, with a focus on cancer, in fact, two types of events occur that, in fact, somehow modify this physiological pathway. One, which is a classical event and which has many consequences for oncogenesis, which is in fact the loss of function of the DNA damage response, for example, but among others, a loss of P53 function. And of course, now you open the gate and the cells can pursue their division. Now the telomeres, they are completely lost or almost totally lost. And you open the two gates, and particularly recombinations that give rise to round of instability. For example, the breakage fusion bridge that were initially, in fact, described by Barbara McClintock, and that contribute, and it has been shown in human cancer, that contribute to cancer formations. I say to contribute because you need another event, which is, of course, the bypass of this proliferation barrier, both given if the DDR exists by the senescence or if the DDR does not exist by this an increase or maybe, let's say, too much of instability. And this has to be corrected, let's say, by a reactivation of the embryonic form of the telomerase. The telomerase is upregulated in cancer cells, in most of them. There is some other pathway, but most in 90% of the cases, whatever the origin. And this contributes to the immortalization of cancer cells. And these two events, which are telomere-related, contribute to cancer formation. So for now, I arrive to my own topic, let's say. And it's really to understand in general terms, but also related to cancer, what is really the role. I mentioned that before, that there is a change in the expression, but it's not so much. Really to understand the details of the mechanism by which this capping complex acts during cancer formation. So to address that, we have a bottom-up approach in the team for a long time, again initiated in Lyon, starting from TRF2 and trying, if we understand, I would not say everything, but many things on TRF2, it's a starting point to maybe understand the rest. On TRF2 has a very strong telomere phenotype when it is inactivated. So specifically, TRF2 and cancer, so in fact, for a long time, not only us, but others, we accumulate a lot of evidence that indeed TRF2 play a role during oncogenesis. So first, descriptive things, so it is overexpressed in many types of cancer, like other proteins, let's say, but the list is very long. It's not exactly the same timing for telomerase. Usually TRF2 is overexpressed early when it has been studied, for example, during colon carcinogenesis. It is activated, or breast cancer, it is activated before, in fact, the appearance of telomerase positive. And signaling pathways that explain this upregulation, the promoter of TRF2, is directly regulated by the Wnt beta-catenin pathway, is what we showed in fact some years ago, relatively recently, but also by the Wnt tumor 1/2 oncogenes. And reversely, in fact, it is inhibited, down-regulated, not directly, indirectly by P53 and ubiquitination. So in terms of expression, clearly there is a link. Functionally speaking, the case, in experimental model, both at cellular and mouse model, indeed, TRF2 contributes to oncogenesis, and this among the things we did, if you change the dosage in both directions, you overexpress TRF2, the tumor appears more rapidly, they are bigger, and in fact, even the overall survival of the mice decrease on the reverse if you knock down TRF2, so this is clear. Now about the mechanism, which is of course the focus of this talk. In fact, we already published, and others, but I think that is mostly our work, two types of mechanisms by which TRF2 contribute to malignant transformations. One which is an obvious one, according to what I said before, an intrinsic one because TRF2 inhibits DDR, and as you know, DDR is a strong oncosuppressive mechanism, but also, and it was much more surprising, and I hope I will have time to say a few words about it, by an extrinsic mechanism, and in fact, it appears that the dosage of TRF2 by non-canonical role is able to modulate and to shape, in fact, the tumor microenvironment by unexpected mechanism. So to start with the classical one, the DDR inhibitions. So some recent work we did on that, so I go very quickly, but it was mostly done in Lyon again. What we brought to the field, I think, so in addition to the initial identification of TRF2, is really to say that TRF2 was first seen as a protein that confers the binding specificity to telomeric DNA. And indeed, it's the case. entities provided by the C-terminal MIB-like telobox domain. But also, we have been able to show by a series of biochemical characterizations that are summarized here, not only us, but also others, that in fact, TRF2 binds different types and through different domains by different types of DNA conformations. And in fact, the idea is that not only TRF2 serves as a platform for interaction for other proteins that could do the job of DDR protection. Certainly is doing that. But also, it changed the conformation of telomeric DNA. And now the game is really to understand how this change in conformation of telomeric DNA, in fact, can explain, at least in part, the DDR protection mechanism. And so recently, and it's really a strong topic now in my team, we focus on a peculiar effect of TRF2 on DNA topology. And it will be the first story I will tell you in more details. Why DNA topology? In fact, DNA topology was not so much studied at telomere before our work, because since you are at the end of chromosomes, the good news is that you are free to rotate. And in fact, the topological problems that encounter, for example, a replisome or any DNA transactions, in fact, have no particular problem when you reach the exterior. So this was the concept, because you are free to rotate, in contrast to the interior of chromosome. As you know, you need topoisomerase to remove the positive supercoil accumulating upstream, for example, the replication fork. And in fact, it's not the case. And in fact, it's what we first clearly described in this paper, that in fact, telomeres appear topologically constrained, and even much more than maybe not all genome regions, but most of them. Why, for example, if we use some topoisomerase inhibitors, some being used, as you know, to cure cancer, in fact, the telomere appear very, very sensitive. I mean, we are able to detect damage before the rest of the genome. So they are very particularly to topoisomerase 2 inhibitions. And this topological property of telomere, we translate them into a particularity of the TRF2 proteins, which are favorite proteins. And in fact, so I don't go into details at this publish, but by using atomic force microscopy, able to detect single molecule and to detect really the volume and occupied by the molecule at the nanometric level, we have been able to show that each time a dimer of TRF2 binds to DNA, it decreases the contour length of DNA that you can easily measure on the image by 27 nanometers. And 27 nanometers correspond to roughly 90 base pairs. And we studied that really in details since several years. And I don't have time, I'm sorry, to give you the detail, but this just has been published this beginning of this year. That in fact, this is due to a wrapping of the DNA around the homodimerization domain of TRF2. So here you have a central domain of TRF2 called TRFH, and here you see an homodimer, like a shape of Earthshore or something like that. And in fact, we show that the DNA, in a non-specific manner, it's not the telomeric DNA specific binding, it's a non-specific binding, a little bit like a nucleosome, if you wish. And, moreover, we have been able to map the residues along this axis that are responsible, which are mostly, I mean, which are lysine and arginine, responsible of this wrapping effect. And if we mutate all these lysine and arginine, we got a mutated form of TRF2 that are unable to perform any wrapping anymore, neither by biochemical assay or also by FM. So you have this wrapping complex that we have been able to detect, dimer, tetramer, and multimer. And here you see the topless topoisomerase, topology less mutant of TRF2. We lose almost all of that. So this was a wonderful tool to study the contribution of this particular effect of TRF2 on DNA topology and DNA protections. So again, I will just summarize the effect. Of course, we express this mutant in tumor cells, and we and others, not only tumor cells, normal on tumor cells, and we studied the contribution of because of the separation of function mutant of TRF2 of topology. And what we observe, and what we have been able to show, is that, in fact, we can is what I said before. We can separate, in fact, this wrapping, DNA wrapping, from the specific binding of TRF2 in terms of protein domain. And in fact, this, as you may know, it has been observed a long time ago that telomere DNA, in fact, fold back into itself and invades the double, the free prime overhang invades the duplex part, forming a so-called T-loop that is believed to be part of the protection mechanism, which is very tempting because you transform a linear problem into a circular one. And in fact, this topless mutant, in fact, lose the ability to form T-loop, is what we show by super-resolution microscopy. And in fact, very interestingly, this topless mutant mimics the effect of critically short telomere. You are still protected against nomogous and joining, but you activate the ATM pathway, that is a specific pathway that is controlled by TRF2 and probably by T-loop formations. And we were relatively surprised to see that we were maintaining the end fusions, because it was believed that this T-loop should protect against nonhomologous joining. That means that if you lose T-loop, you should be able to engage the nonhomologous joining. And in fact, the reason of that is that TRF2 has two partners, I mean, has one partner per monomer, which is a RAP1 protein, and in yeast, RAP1 is an anti-nonhomologous joining protein. And indeed, in the context of this topless mutant in these cells, if we, in addition, remove RAP1, now we activate nonhomologous joining. That means that RAP1 is a backup mechanism, and in fact, indeed, this T-loop and controlled by this topology is indeed responsible of protections both against ATM and nonhomologous joining. So this was the first story. The second story is whether this type, because DNA topology, as I say, it's a general problem in chromosomes, so whether, in fact, TRF2, I don't know, could be of some help elsewhere. And to address whether TRF2 has extra telomere. So we had other reasons to think that, but I don't go into detail. So we did a ChIP-seq, classical approach for that. That, in fact, was done in Lyon and published when I was here by Thomas Simonet et al. And in fact, it was a joint publication with another group, and we got similar results. That means that at the genome level, TRF2, so you don't see in detail, but mostly in yellow here, you have all the small, there are small patches of telomeric sequence. A few nucleotides, a few hundred of nucleotides that looks like telomere DNA. They are not telomere, they are just like T2 and G3-like repeats that can be found in our genomes. We don't know so much their functions. They are called ITS for interstitial telomere. So they were known for a long time before. And in fact, so of course, their number can vary according to your bioinformatic parameters, but interestingly, in fact, most of the ChIP-seq hit, of course, in addition to the telomeric sequence, were found in a subset of this interstitial telomeric sequence, mostly roughly 10%. It was really a common thing that was found in these two papers. That means that TRF2 binds to discrete sites along the chromosomes at ITS, and we don't know why. This is not so surprising, because TRF2 is known to bind T2 and G3 repeat. But what was more surprising is that at the same time, and this is illustrated here, some of the hits did not correspond to ITS. And those that did not correspond to ITS mostly were located at the pericentromeric regions, just at the border of unique and repetitive DNA of the MAD genome, and correspond in most of the cases to satellite-free, which is a major repeat found in our pericentromeric regions, satellite-free repeat. And in fact, we confirm the ChIP-seq result by immunofluorescence, and you see here a probe of satellite-free, and you see, of course, the binding of TRF2, the major binding to telomere, but from time to time, we can detect some binding to the pericentromere. So we decide to study that in details, obviously, and we ask whether this TRF2 was also responsible of DNA damage DDR protections at this sequence. To answer this question at the genome-wide level, we perform another ChIP experiment, but now we immunoprecipitate gamma H2X as a marker of DDR comparing cells that, so it doesn't work anymore. Yeah, it works. Comparing control with down-regulated TRF2 down-regulated cells. And again, you can appreciate that globally. In fact, most of the profile, I mean, the increased profile that we have upon TRF2 down-regulations, in fact, there are some exceptions, so there are, maybe we could discuss differently, but this is a zoom. So this is a non-matched genome because you are at the centromere and pericentromere region, but just at those borders, you have this increased presence of gamma H2AX, and we confirm again, we confirm that by different means, and here you can see by microscopy upon TRF2 dysfunctions, we can see if foci of the damage at the pericentromere. That can be detected and controlled. So how TRF2 binds and what is doing there? So it was rather strange. And we screen various putative genes to see those that would influence this binding. And in fact, so most of them, of course, have no effect on the binding of TRF2. A little bit weak, okay, here. But some, in fact, decrease the binding and some increase. And I should say it's not shown here that we measure at the same time the binding at telomeres that remains constant in all these situations, very specific of pericentromere. And very interestingly, those that decrease the binding are those that decrease the heterochromatin aspect of pericentromere, and those that increase are those that are known to create stress of replications, topological stress. And suggesting a link between, of course, replications, heterochromatin replications, TRF2 binding, and damage. So it's what we confirm. So TRF2, indeed, if we make a cell cycle analysis, scoring for EDU positive cells, TRF2 binds more abundantly to replicating cells. And again, this is not really the case for telomeric DNA. Again, it's a pericentromere specific effect. So we went directly to the point and we measure the speed of replication force. In fact, it's ongoing experiments done in collaboration with Michel de Baptiste at Curie Institute in Paris. And in open down regulation of TRF2, it's a plus dog situation. And this is a classical combing experiment to measure the speed of replication force by double labeling IDU and chloro-DU. The DNA in blue, and at the general genome level, there is not so much effect of the absence of TRF2. In most cases, so the speed is normal, roughly 1 kb per minute. But now, in addition, with the PNA probe, we were able to measure the same thing, but only on the satellite-free fibers. And now things change. Now if we look at the with a normal dosage of TRF2, you have a slight decrease of the field, which means that probably the replication is going slower at the heterochromatin region, but even slower in the absence of TRF2. And now we reach 0.6 kb per minute. And to really know whether TRF2 could be directly attracted by the problem posed by the replication in very difficult regions of the genomes, we asked whether really TRF2 could bind independently of the heterochromatin context to a stall fork. That is, in that case, is a classical assay which is created by the large binding of heterologous proteins, the LACAI from E. coli, to a LACO array of site. And this is known before to induce a stall fork on DNA damage. And we make use of this system to measure the binding of TRF2 and the consequence of DNA damage. And this is done, scored mostly by microscopy. We have a GFP foci with the LACAI GFP expressions, and TRF2 binds, in fact, in dividing cells to specifically to this region. And now, if we express a tribrid between LACAI GFP plus HP1 alpha to render, in fact, this region even more heterochromatic, we increase the binding of TRF2. Now, in terms of that, I don't have so much time, I guess. So, in terms of damage, as expected, in fact, we have an increased damage. And theoretically, with the LACAI HP1, we have a little bit less damage. So, we could discuss. And in fact, it's like a telomere. TRF2, in fact, prevents upon ATM activation at SAT-free replications. So, we have others evident, but let's say, so this is an ongoing thing that I hope will be submitted soon. So we believe that this is our model, that there are several reasons for which, in fact, TRF2 can bind to STAL4-cat heterochromatin, at least some of them, so the positive supercoil, and as I showed you before, because you have an accumulation of topological problem, probably during these replications, branch DNA, the STAL fork, but also maybe a regress fork, creating some kind of double strand break. We know that TRF2 binds to a platform for a resolvase named SLX4 and others. So now we have to decipher what is the contribution of those. But the fact is that it binds. And we also know that TRF2 can attract various helicases, and you remember some of them were directly involved in this binding, like Werner, Blum, Hertel. And we believe that whatever is the nature of this heterochromatin barrier, which in fact has to be defined, we believe that probably through the recruitment of this enzyme somehow, TRF2 breaks the wall and allows the fork to pass through this topological barrier. I reached, more, I guess, more or less my time. I will say a few words about the extrinsic one. And so this, to come back to the ChIP-seq, and maybe you notice that I forget about ITS. And in fact, so this is a separate story, partly published, that in fact, the binding of TRF2 as ITS, I said nothing to do with DDR protections, but has to do with transcriptional regulation. And in fact, these ITS are close to genes, and when they are bound by TRF2 in this particular cell line I showed you before, and maybe others, in fact, the binding of TRF2 in most of the cases where we studied that activates the transcription of these genes. So I don't go into details, but we test not all of them, but a large subset, and every time, each time we test them, in fact, we have a decrease of the expression upon TRF2 dysfunctions, also at the protein level, and also in a luciferase assay, when we use an ITS of these genes as an enhancer, and in fact, we have a large increase of the expression upon TRF2 overexpression. And at the chromatin level, in fact, this correlates, and this is really ongoing work in the team, this correlates with a particular profile of enhancer, of enhancer-like, and in fact, so each line is a different ITS of the human genomes, and the dots correspond to those that are bound by TRF2. And you see that, in fact, with mostly for H3K27 acetylated, we have a clear enrichment of this mark at this ITS, particularly those that are bound by TRF2, the same for RNA polymerase 2, a little bit, maybe it's less pronounced, but a little bit also for K4 monomethyl, but not for the other mark, which appears, of course, as you can see, totally random. So the take-home I would like to give, I don't have time to go into more unpublished data, so this was published, that at least one of these genes, HS3-ST4, which is a gene involved in the biosynthesis of heparan sulfate proteoglycan, in fact, so it's upregulated by TRF2 in tumor cells, but moreover, it has cell extrinsic effect on the inhibitions of the recruitment of natural killer cells that, in fact, contribute to the take of this tumor in mouse, and we think in human, this of course is difficult to directly show. So the new things I wanted to say today is that we make now a syngenic model using B16 mouse melanoma cell line. We make a systematic analysis of the microenvironment induced by TRF2 dysfunctions, both up and down regulations. And we were able to show that in addition to NK cells, we have a modification in the number of activated T cells. They are down, their density decrease upon TRF2 overexpression and increase upon TRF2 down regulations. And we have exactly the reverse, which is expected from an emotional point of view of regulatory T cells and for myeloid-derived suppressive cells, MDSC. Exactly the same pattern in addition to NK. And now the game that we are pursuing is ready to understand how TRF2 controls all this immunosuppressive environment. And so I don't have time, I go very quickly, but the take home is that indeed MDSA appears to be a key target, a direct target for TRF2 dosage in tumor cells, much more than NK cells. We believe that the effect on NK cells is indirect through MDSC. For example, if we deplete MDSC, we reduce totally the tumorigenicity due to TRF2 overexpressions. And in fact, and this is a key experiment, we are able to, in direct co-culture, to activate MDSC by modulating the expression of TRF2 in vitro, either by downregulation TRF2, we decrease MDSC activation, here you see as a phosphostat-free by cytometry, and overexpression of TRF2 we increase. So we link this effect, and this will be among the last slide, we link this effect to a set of genes that were found by ChIP-seq and that are found to be regulated by TRF2 through ITF binding. And very interesting, each of these genes, so I already report HS3, ST4, but also Versican or Mucin1, GPC6, and Lipocalin, in fact, have a specific role either in the recruitment of MDSC, their activation, separate role, and activation and recruitment of NK cells with a direct effect on NK through MDSC. So this is the finish. So in fact, what we learn is that the effect of TRF2, surprisingly, in tumor is not so much maybe due to telomere protections, but it's massively due to this transcriptional effect of a network of genes that share probably common enhancer involved in immune surveillance in tumor cells. But also maybe, so now, of course, has to be studied in more detail, and we start to have the separation of function mutant about heterochromatin replication, so of course, telomere protection. And we believe that beyond the knowledge on this mechanism, this should allow us to have specific pharmacological approach to maybe target oncogenic effects of TRF2 that are independent of chromosome stability that could be interesting new type of chemotherapy. Drug. And all the pericentromeric work, satellite-free, is the work of Aaron Mendes, postdoc together with Ludmila, Lotoska, PhD students. All the topological things were done by Marie-Jo Giropani, Sabrina, and the immunological things is mostly done by Julien Cherfis. I thank you.